down to, on the street with her, and I was holding her head in my lap. And I yelled for my sister to call the paramedics. And then they took her to the hospital.
Where was Kenneth at the time?
I don't know. He was somewhere. He wasn't there. When she finally got out of the hospital and she got her slight memory back, she moved in with us, me and my mom.
How was she with her head injury?
And she wasn't the same after that.
She wasn't the same after the head injury?
Mm-mm, she wasn't. If you really knew Pauline like I did, mm-hmm. you wouldn't like her. Pauline, that girl, God rest her soul, but that girl, she did some effed up stuff to that man. The police used her to make him say that he did. He didn't do it. I'd swear on my soul, that man did not kill that girl.
I've always been taught and always learned that no case is ever done. No case. And so I've located this world-renowned neuropsychologist, Dr. Pantan. I've sent him over the reports about Pauline and her head injury and her statements that she made describing the jewelry to the police. I'm on my way to get his analysis of those records.
I have a brain model here just to give you a sense. So she was involved in a bicycle accident. She fell from her bicycle to her right side, and she had a skull fracture. And then underneath the fracture, there was a bleed. And the bleed was impacting the right parietal area of the brain. People who have injuries in this area of the brain act out in inappropriate ways.
This is Pauline Flores, her admission diagnosis, head trauma, epidermic hematoma, and skull fracture. Mm. Psychiatry agreed that the patient was still mentally greatly disabled. Hospitalization was appropriate, and a 72-hour hold was obtained on the patient.
She had a sick hold.
Yeah.
She was being combative.
Yes.
Yeah. So we think Kenneth Clare did 10, maybe 20 burglaries right around the same time period.
Yes.
So the idea that Pauline has confused burglaries is actually, dare I say, a plausible one.
The critical issue here is that this patient had a severe traumatic brain injury with profound memory problems.
It was the detail, description, and memory of Pauline describing the jewelry that she says was in Kenneth Clare's possession that night.
Mm-hmm.
That was critical to the jury coming to the conclusion that he was the person who killed Linda Faye Rogers.
She is reporting that she remembers information from 16 days after the injury for a patient to be able to encode and retrieve that information after such a traumatic brain injury. It's so improbable, it is almost impossible. Her testimony should not be accepted.
20 years later, Pauline Flores actually made a declaration and recanted her testimony. Pauline Flores agrees that there's no way she could have remembered that level of detail about the jewelry items that she testified to in the trial. It says, after my release from the hospital, I spent at least 2 to 3 weeks of rehabilitation and did not come out of my home alone because I could not function normally. I needed help to regain my normal speech. I had to have assistance walking, and I suffered nearly a complete memory loss.
If an expert witness like Dr. Pantan had testified at trial for Kenneth Clare, no doubt in my mind that the jury would have completely disregarded Pauline Flores' testimony about her recollections, the descriptions of the jewelry, and all of the other details that she provided about November 15th at trial. It still leaves us with the tape. The biggest piece of evidence that got Kenneth Clare found guilty was the so-called confession that he made in the course of this long tape segment with Pauline Flores.
police convinced Pauline to wear a wire and to have a conversation with Kenneth Clare. And she kept on asking Kenneth, what did you do? You know, did you kill her?